Robbie, I am just very impressed. I wanted to walk out and get a picture of this, and I wanted to get our camera lady to really look your rig over. I just think that's super duper. It's one of the best setups I've seen in a long time. I really like it. I may have you build me one of these buggers.
It works good.
Robbie, you come down to do your continuing education like a lot of the other guys. And I have noticed the guys that do that, they've come down here at the convention. How did it come out for you?
Oh, great. Definitely learned a lot at the convention this year. Took some extra classes on some flex therapy with the horses. Seen a lot of, you know, anywhere you go to me, I learn something new off anybody I talk to.
You know, horse owners, Robbie, are demanding a more trained farrier. I mean, a lot of different things, because they want a farrier that understands nutrition. They want a farrier that understands just, I mean, a farrier today is a big demand, and he has to continue his education. And I try to tell other farriers, you know, if you want to move up the ladder and to really take care of some more better clientele, better, because a lot of them demand it.
Absolutely. I mean, the more you learn, the more you have to offer to the client. The more knowledge that you have, the better you're going to be able to take care of that client and the problems that they have with that horse.
While we're here, Robbie, I know the folks out there, I want them to see, and it'll probably be a lot of farriers that want to look at your rig. You designed this yourself, right?
Yes.
Let's walk around, and I'm going to get our camera person to come around and look at this. I just think it is really, and I'm going to go over some of it, and you correct me if I'm wrong. But I notice you've put this giant pole here, and everything swings off of that pole. You built all this yourself?
I did. I've seen a lot of different designs and tried to look at a lot of other people's designs and what they were doing. And I tried to do something that was effective as far as gave me more room in the trailer. But I don't like picking that anvil up 10 or 12
either.
Times a day.
I don't either.
So I wanted something, you know, that made it simplified in that manner. So that's the best thing that I've come up with so far.
I notice you've got hammers, you've got your fire, everything's at hand reach. I mean, and the way it swings out, there's no big work to it. You got your own, you got a little kitchen in there too, I see.
I do. It's actually got a hot water heater. We can heat up water if we got to soak a horse's feet for therapy. It's and of course I can kind of wash up a little bit in between chewing appointments as well.
Rob, if you don't mind me asking, what does that tie up as far as finance? Give us kind of a ballpark figure. And I know you got a lot of labor in there that you don't count, but just in material and the trailer and what have you got in it, not counting your labor?
I'd say not counting my labor, roughly $16,000-$17,000.
And, you know, that's what I wanted the folks out there to understand. The farriers that really are into the shoeing, really trying to take care of the horses correct, you have to have almost a machine shop when you go out there. And these guys tie up a lot of money in their trailers. And they fix it where they can work, and they don't work off just a back of a truck. So when you do that, when you get out there, you're prepared to do most anything.
Well, absolutely. And, I mean, what I found is normally, you know, you put extra stuff on your trailer, usually from the mistakes you've made, where you get out the shoe somewhere and you don't have what you need. And that's what, you know, same thing. That's part of it's where I put that stuff on, where I was missing something.
Robbie, now give me an idea exactly the town and how far away from your town you work in general.
I live in Sylvan, North Carolina. Normally I travel up in around Asheville, Hendersonville. That's out hour and a half, hour and 45 minutes radius of Sylvan, North Carolina.
So you're going a little bit farther. Most of the guys are 50, some of them are 75. So give us an idea, 75, 80 miles?
I'd say I've been running some of them up to maybe 100, 110 miles in some clients.
When you go out, what are you doing when you go out? Do you do five horses, six horses? What's your goal and your stopping point? Because I see a lot of guys just try to overdo it, and then they get tired at the end of the day and they sort of skip on the next. And the horse owners are demanding service. They want somebody that's there on time. Are you finding more people are willing to pay more to have service?
I do. I mean, I'm I guess as you can see that trailer, I'm nitpicky. I'm particular with what I do. And when I go out, I want to do somebody's horse the same way I do mine. So, I mean, normally I spend quite a bit of time on a horse. You know, maybe even any horse from iron, 40 minutes, 2 hours, you know, depending on what's wrong with the horse.
In other words, you're going to take your time.
I want to, and when I schedule my appointments, I want to have enough time that I don't have to leave to make a nut to keep from being late somewhere else.
Right.
So, I mean, personally.
I think that's where a lot of guys mess up. They try to push it too much. And they charge, get a little too cheap on the price. They got to do too many horses. And then they wind up being late all the time. And that's one of the big complaints that we've had from people calling. The farrier don't show up on time. Sometimes they don't show up. And I think, to me, from what we've gathered doing convention and listening to the horse owners are willing to pay more to get a farrier that's willing to spend the time to take care of the horse correct. Are you finding that to be true?
Absolutely. I mean, they, you know, people, depending on how you're shoeing, they may end up having to take a half a day off of work, or they rearrange their schedule to meet you. And that's, you know, definitely, if you're late, I get clients all the time saying, you know, can't get my farrier to come out. Can't get him when he's supposed to be. So
I'm going to have them put on the screen your phone number and hold it up there where you're located, where the folks out there can have something and call. And if you miss it, gang, all you got to do is call the office and they'll give you Robbie's number. Another thing, Robbie, I want to do while we're standing here talking, because we're so handsome, we're going to show other things. Let's show a little bit of the convention and the things that were actually going on here this year, because there was a heck of a lot. We had massage, we had dental, we had all kinds. And, you know, I have found, and by listening, and I learn a lot, especially from this dentist that came up this time, that's doing dental work on the horse, that a lot of times when you're out shoeing and you recommend, you're looking at a horse's teeth, you got an idea if that horse needs to be done, because the hooves themselves, what that horse eats is going to affect his hooves.
Sure.
And so it's become where a farrier's got to understand the nutrition, he's got to understand the grass, he has to understand the stall work, everything that happens to a horse, he's got to be up to date on. Are you finding that more true?
Absolutely. I mean, that, you know, just like you said, the more that I can know, you know, being a farrier is my job, you know, the nutrition end of it, or what the horse is eating that's affecting his feet. Things like that. Same way with, you know, the teeth. If hooks is on the teeth and whatnot, that may be causing. So anything that I can add to the game, that's what I want to do.
Well, see, that's what I think the owners are demanding. They're demanding a farrier that really continues education. And you're listening to Robbie. And Robbie, we just tickled to have you on the show. So we're going to hold up, pull our muse in, let the folks take a break. We're going to be right back.